Good afternoon. You all know who I am, obviously. I just introduced myself, but again, I'm Jackie Van Wormer, and I'm the Spokane Regional Criminal Justice Administrator. All of you around this table have been so active with us over the past, 18, 24 months as we have really taken a deep dive into our criminal justice reform efforts and built such a collaborative synergy around this reform efforts that I'm so pleased at where we are, how far we've come, and where we're heading. And I think that it will mean so much for our community. When you have a criminal justice system that is fair and balanced and effective, you create a healthier community. We know that. You create a community that is more economically viable, where families want to live and where they want their children to go to school and where our insurance rates are manageable. And so having an effective criminal justice system, I know, has been very important to this group, and we've been very focused on creating efficiencies and effectiveness in our system. Part of that has been, over the past 3 years, city and county officials, all of you around this table, have been looking at various options in order to reduce our local jail population. We know that our jail has been overcrowded for quite a period of time, and really looking at better alternatives for our local jail population. We had this opportunity just about 18 months ago to participate in the MacArthur Foundation Safety and Justice Challenge. And as you are all aware, we were one of the 20 sites selected from 191 applicants to take a deep dive and look at our local jail population and figure out how can we reduce our jail population safely, how can we reduce the length of stay, and how can we reduce and address racial and ethnic disparities in our criminal justice system. And so of those 20 sites, 10 were selected for further investment by the foundation, and we were one of those 10 sites, so that was a $1.75 million investment. And if you remember, we had four core strategies that we're working on. So the first was a development and implementation of a risk needs responsivity system. And we had a committee that met for many, many months, chaired by Cheryl Tolfsrud from Detention Services and Bonnie Bush from the Juvenile Court, and that group met for really well over a year. They looked at all sorts of risk assessment tools. They looked at tools that were available on the market for purchase that could be utilized without cost or minimal cost, and really settled on this idea of customizing a local risk assessment that could be normed and validated on our local population so that we could ensure that it met the needs of our community. And so that's one of our strategies, was to implement this risk needs responsivity system, starting with a pretrial tool. Our second strategy was building up a robust pretrial department so that if the judges make decisions using this risk assessment tool, that these individuals are safe to be in the community, that we have supervision, we have monitoring for these individuals. And we, in addition to having pretrial services, working with these individuals in the community, we're placing social workers or case managers in the public defender's offices to assist individuals in getting housing, getting employment opportunities, counseling, mental health services, needed resources to help as they're navigating through the criminal justice system. And then, of course, we're looking to build greater diversionary opportunities for those that are eligible, especially around mental health. And then finally, an integrated justice court, which we know that in our community, Washington State does not have a unified court system. We have separate court systems. So an individual can be arrested on a single incident, but yet land in numerous court systems, which can sometimes create confusion and duplication. And so the idea of creating an integrated justice court sort of brings that all under one judge, one prosecutor, one public defender for that point of first appearance. So that has been the core strategies that we've been working on under the MacArthur Foundation project. Kind of the umbrella over all of that, of course, is community engagement, working very closely with our community on this, and then addressing racial and ethnic disparities across all points of the criminal justice system. So we were very excited. We've been working real hard with Washington State University to help develop our local tool. And over the Christmas holidays, we were finally able to launch what is called the SAFER tool, which stands for Spokane Assessment for Evaluation of Risk. And this tool is currently being used on a limited basis in Superior Court, and it will soon be used probably by mid-February or so in Municipal Court, and then we'll be moving into District Court. And the tool weighs and uses numerous factors to provide a score for judges to help judges make a decision about whether an individual is safe to be released into the community, safe to be released under pretrial monitoring, or if they should be detained in the jail. Okay? We want to make sure that we have, with such a crowded jail, we have the right people in jail, and those that can be safely monitored can be put within the community. When law enforcement has a continual frustration with arresting some of these same individuals, and there's not a bed available at the jail. So how do we make those beds available for those that are most high risk, and then place other individuals that are low to moderate risk out within the community under supervision? And that's where we're focused. And that's the exciting part about what this tool can bring to this process, as just another tool for judges to use from the bench. So again, the SAFER tool was launched just, I think, on the 28th of December in Superior Court, and we've been testing a few cases. We built this tool based on 13,000 records from our local population. And like I mentioned, there's numerous factors that go into measurement, including the current charge, the pending charges, criminal history, warrant information, age, and some other demographic information. And some social history type of information. And so what I want to do now, we'll do some questions here at the end, but I do want to turn it over to Judge Moreno, because Judge Moreno is going to talk about the importance of the use of this SAFER tool and what this means for our community from the standpoint of the judicial perspective. And again, what we're looking at with this tool and what it's set to do is to tell us whether or not somebody is low, moderate, or high risk to appear back in court, should we release them, and then low, moderate, or high risk for recidivism. This tool is so nuanced and so specialized to our local area that we're even able to talk about, we were able to build certain models around violent crimes and property crimes and drug crimes. So the judge now has this level of detail to know if this person should be released, their propensity to commit a new property crime while they're out is between 20 and 30%, for example. That's just an example. This is a mock-up up here on this board of what these risks, what the tool looks like when the judge is looking at it from the bench. So I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to the judge, and we'll take questions in a little bit.
Thanks. So hi, I'm Marianne Marino. I'm one of the 12 Spokane County Superior Court judges. And I can't tell you how excited and happy I am that we have finally launched this tool. We're laughing over there because I have some talking points, but I feel like I've been living and dreaming about this for a long time. And the reason for that, and it sounds kind of silly, but the reason for that is because one of the hardest jobs that we do as judges is making those release decisions. We have lots of information that the state and the defense gives us. We know a little bit about the defendant. But really what we're trying to do is we're trying to release the right people and hold the right people. And sometimes in the past, that has been sort of, at least for me, sort of like a Ouija board, trying to figure out, well, is this person safe to be in the community? Should I be releasing this individual? Because it's quite likely he's not going to reoffend. Before this, we really did not have any evidence-based tools to assist us in making that decision. So now, in addition to the wealth of information that the prosecutor gives us and pretrial services gives us, as well as the defense, and sometimes there's family in the courtroom, we now have an evidence-based tool that we can look at that will score an individual. And it's not the be-all and end-all. It doesn't answer the question. It's just one of the tools in the toolbox. And for me, the use of that tool really allows me to make these decisions much more competently, and I think makes me feel that I can assist somehow in making our community safer. The other piece of it that I think I'm also excited about is the Pretrial Services Department. With the use of the MacArthur funds that we were so lucky to have, and are so lucky to have, we're able to hire enough individuals in that department to not only assist us with running this tool, but also as a support and a monitoring service for these individuals to make reminder phone calls. Because face it, some folks just don't come to court because they forget. And so, you have a reminder phone call, it prompts you. And we also have the ability to not necessarily go out into the community and supervise these individuals, but to monitor them and to triage them and to give them referrals into services. Because we know that a lot of these people are very high needs. They may not be high risk, but they're very, very needy individuals. So I'm very excited for the launch. I know that somewhere along the line here, we're going to be dealing with and implementing our integrated justice court, which is going to be another big piece of this that I think will hopefully help us to reduce failures to appear and to reduce recidivism. So thank you.
Your investments in our community have increased our capacity. You've challenged our timelines and helped us move, speed things up. And you've really challenged us on our goals so that we are going above and beyond what we had originally anticipated for community, for a greater impact for all, those in the criminal justice system and also for the taxpayers in this community, who ultimately are the ones that that pay the bill every single day. So your investment in us is really helping us move forward a project that we did already have on our radar screen and moving forward, but you've allowed us to take it to the next step, and we do really appreciate that. So through the efforts of the Spokane Regional Law and Justice Council, Spokane County and the City of Spokane are working towards reducing our jail population. I think Jackie laid out the goals of the council very nicely. As we work for criminal justice reforms within this community so that we can streamline our processes, so that we can find those efficiencies, ensure fairness within the system, and ultimately make sure that we're holding pretrial defendants accountable. It's important as we look at the criminal justice system in Spokane County that, and specifically the jail, that we understand what it is that it's costing us as a community. You know, the average daily jail population has gone up significantly since 2000, to the point that in 2015, we have an average of 965 inmates per day within our jail. And we are on active emergency status within our jail for critical status because of the overpopulation of our jail. And if you think about the fact that each of those inmates cost the county about $130 per day, per inmate, that is not insignificant, especially when you translate that over into a total dollar figure and you realize that that's about $40 million a year that we spend in Spokane County to operate our jail. So we're talking big dollars that have an impact on local taxpayers. And as we know, the ramifications of that go much beyond the jail to the rest of the system. Yet so often, and you're going to hear us say this over and over again, we don't have the right people in jail. Many of the folks that are going into our jail system have mental health or chemical dependency issues. They are low risk to our community, but that's where they end up. And so as we are working about being smarter on our criminal justice system, we want to make sure that it's the right people that are in our jail. And that we are being smart about the system so that we're keeping the community safe, but also ensuring that we are not overloading an already overloaded facility. So it's important for us that we are continually looking for reform efforts that are focused on the individual that's going through the system, not just the crime. They're focused on the victims to ensure that there's restitution. They're focused on the community who is ultimately paying the price tag at the end of the day. So it's exciting that we have, this is just one additional tool in the toolkit for our judges to be able to use, and it's exciting for them to be able to implement this safer tool that really does highlight the difference between low risk and high risk individuals to make sure that we're keeping those right individuals in the community. And the best part of this is just one of many great announcements that we are going to be making this year as we really see all of the work that we've been working on for the last year and a half, and actually prior to that, really come to fruition. So thank you again for joining us on this day.
Well, let me first echo what the commissioner said. I just want to thank our partners again for being here, but more importantly, for embarking on this journey with us a couple years ago now. It reminds me when this all started that it was a partnership with the county and the city that we brought citizens together to look at a blueprint for reform and to look at each and every one of these. And it showed to me over and over again that is in the city, as we build the city of choice of being safer, stronger, and smarter, you couldn't see a project or initiative that does just that. Obviously, and I think it's ironic that this tool is called the SAFER tool, because I don't quite know whether SAFER is a word, but I More Safe didn't work with the alliteration of our initiative. So, but that being said, as those three came together, over and over again, you saw centers of excellence throughout our system. And to highlight those centers of excellence in that report, to knowingly and see those myself, and to bring those forward and really put them throughout the piece. My direction and my hope in that commission that was set forth by our elected leaders was to do two things: to reduce recidivism, and that is so key as we talk about focusing on the person and not the crime, but really the entire picture, and to give the tools to those that are on the front lines of this, whether it be in the court system, whether it be in probation, whether it be in law enforcement, whether it be in our jails, you name it, and the many partners of the nonprofits and NGOs that we have here. But that was number one. Our public's number one concern is safety, and recidivism, as you look at this, is a key component of that. The second is the affordability of this. It is a cornerstone of my administration to truly look at the affordability to our citizens of how government operates. And that really leads us, in most cases, to the third part of our initiatives of doing things smarter. And today we're celebrating one of those ways and giving the tools of how we do things smarter. And it's within the means of our citizens. I see every day, often more than once, the disparity in our neighbors and in our neighborhoods in the city, and frankly also in the aggregate of looking at the median household income of those that are in our city at $43,000. We're very pleased that it's up double digits in the last couple of years. But to think that the baseline living paycheck to paycheck in our community, in our city, is $55,000, and then to think that our citizens are making $43,000, the reality is the affordability of our system has to be affordable to those that we serve. And otherwise, you get in a spiral that doesn't solve itself. And so to really focus on the individual, to focus on those pieces. And as this tool, as we come together and I think about in the MacArthur Foundation, again, selecting this cooperative, this coming together, it always amazes me to see that the separate elected officials that are here, not only that, but those of you that serve and have served our community in every facet of the criminal justice system, it comes down to the individual, like the commissioner talked about, that we all know. It comes down to the citizen, it comes down to the taxpayer, it comes down to the person that is finding themselves in this system. So everything from healthcare to business to government, this is so key. And so I just want to say that this is a milestone that is worth coming together. It is amazing to me, quite frankly, your timelines. I love them. And this community knows that I'm a flash to bang person pretty quickly. But it always amazes me when I come to this organization how quickly, and I just must say to those of you that are part of this system, and frankly, to make sure that we aren't too quick. The rights of those that are in our system, time is a part of that. And there is a balancing act that I'm glad is not in front of me on a daily basis, but I do know is in front of many of you here on a daily basis of literally going back to the roots of this country of a speedy trial, but a fair trial. And how do you do that? And time and the tools we use is critical to that. And I've always found that although we seek efficiency and we think that is the epitome of the goal, I'm here to say, and it was told to me by a mentor of mine, we may not have the most efficient government in the world, but we believe we have the most effective government. And in that case, the pieces that come together and the separate interests that are here shouldn't be the thing that divides us. It's the thing that brings us together, because we bring different interests here. So congratulations on this milestone. And I really do believe it is the continuation of milestones that have already been met and really a prelude to the many things that are coming in front of us.
I'll make it very, very quick. You get too many elected officials in a room and they all want to speak. We know that pretrial stays and jail crowding is part of a nationwide problem. Our jails in Spokane County are overcrowded, and like jails across the county, we hold people for nonviolent offenses in prolonged periods of time, often simply because they cannot afford to post bail. That is an unsustainable practice and is not making the best use of our resources. The SAFER tool introduces a solution for those who pose no threat to public safety, to resources designed to keep them from becoming repeat offenders. This is a better solution than just building a bigger jail. The tool is an assessment of an individual's need and public safety risk that gives judges the information they need. I'd like to finish by thanking everybody that's around this table and also all the community members. This is every month the most attended meeting, the most involved meeting from people involved in a system and involved in the community. I want to call out Spokane County, law enforcement, probation, prosecutors, the jail administration, judges, public defenders, and community members, and finally the MacArthur Foundation for their partnership in this effort. Together we all do make a difference. This is meaningful work. Thank you.